Okay, so I'm Kitt Healy. I was mentioned just a minute ago. I have two jobs. I have many jobs at the moment, but two of them are relevant to right now. So I'm the grants advisor for the Michael Fields Agricultural Institute, as well as working for Dr. Dawson at the University of Wisconsin as an outreach and research specialist. The project that I'm telling you about today was actually the project I did for my master's research with Dr. Dawson, which I finished up last spring. And this project is ongoing, so I have a couple of new results that I've thrown in here, even though they weren't technically part of my project. But to start, we'll just start with a couple of facts about tomatoes. First fact is that everyone loves tomatoes. This is an objective fact, scientifically proven. So basically, we decided to work on tomatoes because they're a very popular crop and they're a very lucrative crop for a lot of organic farmers in the upper Midwest. Tomatoes are the most consumed vegetable in the United States. The certified organic tomato production has increased 277% between 2007 and 2011. So there are a lot more people growing organic tomatoes right now. And in a survey that one of my colleagues, Alex Lyon, did in Wisconsin, she found that tomatoes, tied with winter squash, were the top priorities for organic vegetable breeding in the state of Wisconsin. I imagine that that is similar for the other states in the North Central region in the upper Midwest, although they're Packers fans, so I don't know if we can trust them, but I think we might give them the benefit of the doubt. And the reason why that's important, why we want to know what organic vegetable growers are interested in doing breeding work for, is this quote or this statistic here on the bottom. I don't know if you guys can see. Am I in your way? Okay, cool. Which says that 95% of crops grown on organic farms worldwide, approximately, were not bred for organic conditions. So that means that even if you're buying organic seed, that crop might have been selected, or most likely was selected, in a conventional input environment. Which means that, and then there's other follow-up research to show that crops that were not bred in organic environments lack really important traits for organic farmers, like the ability to scavenge nutrients from farther down in the soil strata, so that you, because you're not applying a whole lot of readily available nutrition to the plant right at the top of the soil. So that's just one example of many. There's lots of research on this coming out now, especially about the importance of breeding crops specifically for organic systems, making selection in organic systems so that we know that those crops are well adapted to the environment that you all will be growing them in. Page down. Damn it. Okay. Okay, so after talking to organic farmers in Wisconsin and in other parts of the upper Midwest, we determined the following trait priorities for tomatoes. Disease resistance was a really important trait that people were interested in, especially foliar diseases. So this is, I think, a picture of our dear Septoria leaf blight, which we have a lot of in Wisconsin. Alternaria is another one that's early blight, late blight, and then some of the other kind of speck and spot diseases that tend to be very, very common. So that was one thing that we were looking at, is there any disease resistance that we can capitalize on to help breed some tomatoes that are better for organic farmers? Yield is always important. That's kind of a no-brainer. If it doesn't make tomatoes, it's no good. And then physiological issues, like anyone who's ever grown a sun gold thinks that splitting is a problem. Because it is for a lot of tomato plants, especially there's a common perception, which is often true, that heirloom tomatoes tend to split a lot more than the kind of red, round, modern slicer tomatoes. So we wanted to look at that, the splitting growth habit. That means whether it's a determinant or an indeterminant that's rangy and all over the place, that matters to a lot of farmers. People who grow in high tunnels tend to like the indeterminate ones, so they can string them up, and then people who grow in the field in multiple successions tend to like the determinant tomatoes. But interestingly enough, the most important thing for people was flavor. So that makes a lot of sense. You know, I've heard somebody say it doesn't matter if the tomato can shoot lasers out of its petioles. If it doesn't taste good, people aren't going to buy it, and it's not going to do the farmer any good. This is another way of representing basically the same information. This is from a national survey that we did recently in preparation for another project. Basically, we asked farmers, what are the qualities of different fruits and vegetables that you need to know before you make your variety decisions? So what are you curious about before you start growing a new variety of tomato? And the larger words had more answers and the smaller words had fewer answers. So it was pretty consistent with what we had found a couple of years before, that flavor is really important, followed by disease resistance and yield, and then people want to know days to maturity more as a practical consideration. So that led to our research questions, which are which varieties and breeding lines. So we weren't only working with finished varieties, we also worked with some earlier generation material, exhibit superior performance in organic production environments. And then we also, understanding that a lot of organic farmers grow their tomatoes in hoop houses, greenhouses, high tunnels, wanted to add a season extension element on top of this variety trial element. So we also asked, how does organic hoop house production compare to organic field production in terms of yield, disease, and flavor? So I'll move very quickly through the research design. We basically had a side-by-side field and hoop house at the West Madison Agricultural Research Station on certified organic land there. We had 42 varieties in 2014, the first year of the study, 37 varieties in 2015. I think we're still somewhere in the 35 varieties range. Two plots of each variety in each environment. So we had replication in the two different environments and then replication within environments. And then we tried to manage them as identically as possible without, you know, being ridiculous. So basically, if it rained a lot in the field, we would not then overwater the hoop house to try to compensate for the rain in the field. We wanted to manage both the field and the hoop house as a farmer would manage them and try to see what kind of results we got. So for management, we used a rye cover crop and compost and pelleted chicken manure to achieve our desirable rate of fertility. We drip irrigated, used plastic mulch in both the hoop house and the field, and then we sprayed EF400, which is an organic blend of essential oils that smells wonderful and supposedly prevents late blight. It's a fungicide. It was moderately effective. We can talk about that later if anybody wants to. There's the label, if anyone's curious about EF400. So we use the single string trellising system, which a lot of people use in the hoop house, a basket weave in the field. We pruned the indeterminate varieties and did a little bit of pruning on the determinants, but not very much, just for airflow mostly. And then we harvested twice weekly in 2014, but reduced that to once weekly to save on labor in 2015. And we found actually that that did not change our it did not increase our rate of unmarketable tomatoes to harvest less. So that worked out very nicely for us. And then we'll get into some of the results. So one of the important results that will not be surprising to anyone is that there was a temperature differential between the hoop house and the field. The hoop house, on average, was about 10 to 12 degrees higher. But it's not really the averages that matter in this situation. It's the spikes, which I don't have on here, but the hoop house, because we did not have automated sidewalls, the hoop house occasionally would get into the hundreds, 110, over 110 degrees. And that, we'll see how that played out in our yield data, which was important. So if anyone is considering doing a hoop house and you have the capacity to do automated sidewalls, I would highly recommend doing that, because if you don't get there right in time, temperature spikes for tomatoes above about 95 degrees can cause blossom abortion and pollen, a reduction in pollen viability. So it's really important to try to keep your tomatoes in a good range. But that being said, if it's warmer earlier, you can plant earlier, which is great. So looking at our yield data, we found a significant difference in yield between the hoop house and the field. You can see the hoop house is the red bars and the field is the blue bars. And then what you see in this section is basically how we analyzed the data, looking for what was the cause of that difference. Like, what was the cause of the variation that we saw in the field? And using our statistical analysis, we found that management was the most important thing. So more than whether we were growing an heirloom or a slicer or a cherry tomato, whether or not it was grown in the hoop house or the field mattered the most for how well a variety yielded. Yep, let's see. So hoop house production, significantly better than in the field. Now, what I wanted to point out here brings us back to temperature, which is that, so we could start getting yield from the hoop house earlier, which you would expect, and then we get yield from the hoop house a little later, because the hoop house is the red line and the field is this blue line here. And then on the bottom we have date, so that's the progression of time, and then grams is yield on the y-axis there. And so that drop-off in the middle there, where the field spikes above the hoop house, that was about 2 weeks after we got the spike temperatures in the hoop house. So I think that's what happened, is that we ended up with some blossom abortion and not as much fruit, which is something that you would observe, you know, working on a farm, but I think it's kind of interesting that we have a graph about it too, even though it's a pretty obvious thing to think about. So one of the questions that I had was, this higher yield that we're seeing in the hoop house, is that just because the season's longer? Is that just because we started harvesting, you know, 3 weeks earlier and kept harvesting a week and a half later in the hoop house? Or is there an extra effect of season extension? So beyond the, you know, the extra time that you have to harvest, does having a hoop house help increase? And what we found in 2015, working out the math, is that yes, even if you account for season extension, even if you take that out of the equation, you still get an extra bump in yield from growing in a hoop house. And there are lots of different reasons that that could be. One of which, I believe, is being able to control the water. So tomatoes are very sensitive to water, too much water, and they split. And also, you know, if you have a lot of water on the foliage, you're going to have a lot of disease problems. So being able to control the moisture levels, I think, really helps. But we didn't do research on that. That's just my professional opinion. Interestingly, we got the opposite result in 2014, because we had some disease in the hoop house in 2014 that balanced out that extra bump that you might get from growing in the hoop house. The effect of the hoop house in 2014 was primarily the longer season. So seasonality, it's different every time. So here's yield broken out by market class, just to talk about the different things that we grew. We grew heirlooms, large slicers, which are kind of like your big beef type, paste slash ox heart, which are, you know, the more elongated tomatoes that have more flesh and less gel. And then the small slicers are kind of like this, you know, defiant or a smaller version of the big beef tomato. And so as you would expect, the heirlooms overall did not yield as well. But what's interesting is that there's not really any statistical difference. What these bars mean on the top, those little black bars, if those overlap, that means that there was a difference that we could see, but it's not a difference that we might expect to repeat. So that's kind of interesting, because I think there is a lot of kind of maligning of heirloom varieties, that they're not as productive. And our research shows that while that still may be true, it's not something that you would expect to be true every year, all the time, as kind of a natural law of the world. So I'm pulling for heirlooms still. Okay, right. We'll skip that one. Okay, so getting to the varieties, because this is the fun part. Okay, so we took yield measurements on all of the varieties by weighing every tomato that we took out of the hoop house and the field all season long for 2 years. Which was a lot of work. I got really strong. but we learned a lot, which was great. The highest marketable yield, so basically the way that this breaks out, the H and the F are hoop house and field. If it's italicized, that means that it was in the top three of yielders 2 years in a row, so for both years. And then if there's a star, that means that that difference was statistically significant. So again, we would expect it to be repeated in the future. So Plum Regal was a big winner. That's Plum Regal. It's a variety that we got from Johnny's, but also Bejo offers, and a couple of other seed companies offer in organic seed. It's a plum-type tomato that has also, not plum, sorry, a paste-type tomato that has also been bred for good fresh eating quality. So it's also pretty flavorful. It doesn't have that mealy texture that you get from a lot of paste tomatoes. It's a nice tomato. It wasn't a favorite on the flavor spectrum, but it was really great and it yielded like crazy. And it showed some disease tolerance. So we didn't test for disease resistance, which would mean actually looking at the genetics of the plant and seeing if it actually had an ability to shut down disease, but it did a lot better, continued to yield, survived a lot more, lost fewer leaves than a lot of other varieties did when faced with septoria and early blight and things like that. So big thumbs up for Plum Regal. The one with a bunch of numbers and letters, that's a breeding line from Vitalis, which is the organic branch of Enzazodin. That one is a oxheart type tomato that had really, really high yield and not so much disease resistance and not so much on the flavor, but really high yield. A Japanese black trifle is here. This is a really cool one from Territorial Seeds that also yielded a whole bunch. It's kind of a really cool bell-shaped variety. It has a nice green shoulder on top and then a purple, like dark brown purple base. And it's also very, very flavorful. Also just yielded so many tomatoes that I was grateful for now, but when I was weighing them, I wasn't that happy about. Yes. So, yeah. Azurian Crown is a new variety from Keith Mueller at KC Tomatoes in Missouri. He's awesome. You look at the time. Okay. It has some Brandywine lineage, but is a hybrid. It's got pink flesh and then this really beautiful dark purple indigo blush on top that stays after it ripens. So a lot of, I don't know if anyone's grown the indigo line of tomatoes, but they, you know, get dark, but then they turn really red, and by the time they're ripe, they're pretty much all the way red. Azurian Crown keeps its dark purple kind of inky color on the top, and it's really pretty. So write down KC Tomatoes and look it up on the internet. He's not in any catalogs, and he pretty much only will send you seed if you contact him directly. But it's pretty good stuff. So just a plug for Keith Mueller at KC Tomatoes. Garden Gem is the last one that I'll talk about here. I'll mention Genuine just very briefly. Garden Gem was another really kick-butt tomato. It yielded a whole heck of a lot, which I'll tell you what that means later. So Garden Gem, if it was a bigger tomato, definitely would have been the top yielder. Because we measured by weight, the fact that it was a small tomato brought it a little bit farther down the list. But it is a hybrid from Harry Klee at University of Florida. It is also, he's looking for somebody to carry it right now. So hopefully next season you'll be able to buy Garden Gem. I think you can buy it from somewhere small in Florida right now. This might be the first year, but I bet by next year it's going to be in one of the major catalogs. It's a hybrid between the consumer flavor favorite over here is a small heirloom, and then I think it's an early girl or something related to an early girl that's the production quality parent that's the modern variety. So it's a cross between those two or between those two parentages. It has a really great flavor. Very high yielding, also shows some disease tolerance in the field. Definitely one of the favorites that we're going to keep in this project for a long time. And then Genuine had a high marketable yield. I'm not sure why or how, because it got really bad blossom end rot. So that's just what the stats say, but I don't really recommend that tomato. So if you come across Genuine, that's just my opinion, is that it was hard to manage the blossom end rot on that guy. Okay, so notable varieties for disease resistance. This is pretty much the only one that gave us anything statistically significant when it comes to disease tolerance, where we could actually say this is a candidate for having some kind of actual genetic resistance that you can then breed with, was this breeding line from the Organic Seed Alliance. And if you're not familiar with the Organic Seed Alliance, they're definitely worth checking out. They do a lot of really incredible breeding work specifically focused on organic direct market vegetable growers. And they're developing this line of tomatoes that doesn't have a name yet. But if you check them out online, if you send them an email and say, I'm interested in your tomato varieties when you release them, they will let you know when they come out. But the 404, 405 line is really, really great and also has really had a lot of flavor preferences too. So people really like the flavor, which we will come to. Okay, so how did we measure flavor? basically, we did what, if anyone was in Matt Raboin's session earlier today, he talked about BRICS, and it's actually the name of his cider company, which is measuring sugar in solution. So we measured BRICS by putting tomato juice onto a digital refractometer and checking it out to see if there was a sugar difference that you got from growing in the hoop house versus growing in the field. And we found that there is a statistically significant higher sugar concentration from growing in the hoop house than growing in the field. And part of that could be that you can't control the water in the field, so there could just be that they're watery tomatoes growing out when there's a rainstorm, things like that. Although we did test each of these multiple times throughout the season, so it wasn't like we just got it right after the rainstorm and then there was this difference. This was consistent. And also the higher heat in the hoop house could contribute to sugar fixation. I think that's probably a lot of it as well. So that was more significant than variety. So what that means, again, is that the difference in sugar concentration was more controlled by whether it was grown in the hoop house or not than it was by whether it was an heirloom or a slicer. So that's really interesting for people who are trying to decide, you know, should I grow some heirlooms? Is it really worth it? Whether or not you grow in a hoop house actually has more to do with sweetness in a tomato than whether you decide to grow an heirloom or big beef tomato. I just use big beef as my go-to, like red round slicer tomato. Okay, I'm not going to get too much into this graph because it's kind of complicated, but one thing that we found was that people usually think about sugar as a way to anticipate what something's going to taste like. But what we found by doing some background research and research that other people have done who look at flavor all the time is that the acid to sugar ratio, which we can measure, is actually a better predictor of whether or not somebody was going to like a tomato, whether or not the flavor is going to be acceptable. So we did titratable acidity for citric acid content and then used the ratio of the citric acid content to the BRICS to create this graph, which basically tells us that I'm not going to get into this graph too much. I'm just going to say that knowing the acid to sugar ratio is important. Okay, so looking at the acid to sugar ratio, the ones that had a favorable acid to sugar ratio, which actually turned out, one of the reasons it's complicated is that it turned out to be that the lower acid to sugar ratio was preferable. That was more correlated with people liking tomato flavor. But the correlation wasn't very strong. So these are the ones that had that lower, more preferable acid to sugar ratio. You can see Garden Gem and Plum Regal are both on here. But with the exception of a few of these, so Garden Gem, A6, and the 45L 2.3, I'll talk about those in a minute. Those are the only ones from this list that also then came out in our taste tests as being favorites. So this is something we still need to work on, is whether or not this ratio of acid to sugar is actually going to be predictive of whether or not people like the tomato flavor, or whether it's kind of a nice thing to know but really isn't going to tell us very much. So that's something we're still working on, which is why I didn't want to spend too much time on that graph there. So what we'll look at instead are the ones that the people really liked. So we did flavor evaluations with our crew, four times throughout each season, and then we also got a panel of chefs together for this project called the Seed to Kitchen Collaborative, which I'm going to be talking about on Friday, how that all works, to do flavor evaluations of our tomatoes and a lot of other vegetables. They were very generous with their time. So what we found here is that this variety, 45L 2.3, was definitely a flavor favorite. All the chefs really liked it. It got high ranks for flavor intensity, balance of flavor, and overall good flavor, which are pretty much what we looked at. And that's this variety over here on your left of the screen. It's a small orange tomato with green stripes. It has some green zebra parentage. That comes from KC Tomatoes in Missouri. Keith Mueller, he's brilliant. I like everything he does, basically. And then some of the other good ones that we'll just go through. Amish 6, A6, is a open-pollinated, kind of brandywine-like tomato from Craig Grau, who used to be a professor at UW-Madison and now is a hobby tomato breeder. So Craig Grau, his last name is spelled G-R-A-U, and this is kind of his main project. He works on this A6 tomato. Garden Gem, we already talked about, University of Florida. It's great. I think I have a picture of A6 on here. Hold up. There it is. It's big. It's big and delicious. Genuine, that's the one that got really bad blossom end rot. That's from ball seeds, but it did have a really great flavor. So if you have good ways of managing blossom end rot, if that's not a problem for you, I would check out Genuine. It's got a great name because it's a cross between a Genovese-type tomato, which are those kind of ridged tomatoes that you see, and a Brandywine, Genuine, which I thought was clever. But anyways, it's got great flavor. Again, the chefs really, really liked it, as well as our field crew. And then the line demarcates what are some of the results from this year of things that people like. Although OSA 404 was also a flavor favorite in the previous years, but this year it's kind of knocking it out of the park. People are really excited about it. And we do all of our taste tests blind. So basically, if something is recurring, if it keeps coming up in people's flavor favorites, then we know that it's really something special because they're not getting attached to the name. They're not remembering, oh yeah, OSA 404, I tried that last time. It's all blind, it's all brand new every time. Crimson Sprinter is one that many of you have probably heard of. It's kind of an older red round slicer that has really good flavor. It didn't do so well yield-wise, but people really like it. Bolsero is new to us this year. It's a Johnny's variety. I think it's Bolseno, actually. I think that's a typo. It's a Johnny's variety that is both very high yielding, according to our preliminary data from this year, and has been very popular with our taste panels. And then this one at the bottom, OSU P2322, that's a breeding line that is actually has some of the Indigo Rose as its parentage. So if anyone's grown Indigo Rose here, it's a very popular tomato now, but it oftentimes doesn't taste very good, or at least that's what we're finding in the Midwest. So we gave some of that input back to Jim Myers, the breeder, and he started using Indigo Rose as a parent to create a new line of tomatoes that don't have that indigo blush, but have a darker flesh all the way through. And this one actually tastes fantastic. I didn't know that it was his tomato, and I brought this to the chefs for one of our tastings. And they were so excited. They were fighting over the leftovers of this tomato to like use as a garnish in their restaurants that night. So I have a list of breeders to pay attention to in a minute, but Jim Myers at Oregon State University is definitely one of them. He's the originator of the Indigo line of tomatoes, and he keeps doing wonderful things. Oh, that's Bolseno or Bolsero, whatever it is. Okay, breeders to follow. Jim Myers at Oregon State. Mark McCaslin is another plant breeder working on tomatoes for Organic Systems. He used to be an alfalfa, or he still is an alfalfa breeder for Land O'Lakes, I believe, but he's a hobby tomato breeder, a secret organics enthusiast on the side. And so AP Whaley Seeds is the name of the company that he's working with right now to breed some really fantastic, cool, stripy, very, very flavorful tomatoes from lots of different genetic backgrounds, including some that are going to stay on the vine and stay ripe longer than your average tomato that have a ripening inhibitor gene that's totally natural, like no GMO at all. So he'll come up with some really cool stuff. The Organic Seed Alliance, again, check them out if you haven't. And then I forgot to put Keith on here. I don't know why. KC Tomatoes, just KC. Good stuff. Okay, final thoughts, just overview. Higher marketable yield from the hoop house than the field. Season extension may not always be the cause of higher yields, but if you're having a rough year in the field, it can be very, very helpful. Higher sugars in the hoop house, and we need to do some further research on whether or not this acid to sugar ratio actually means anything in terms of flavor. So here is my contact information from the UW. And my advisor slash boss now, Julie Dawson, this is her email address. And so we can send you our more complete reports, including lots of data that you can then look at and play with yourself if you're into that. Thank you very much.
Just a quick question. What was like the breakup of determinant versus indeterminate in your tomatoes?
They were pretty much all indeterminate. We only had a very few number of determinants. I don't think any of which are mentioned on here, but some of the breeding lines were semi-determinate, which was really nice. So it meant that they grew tall, but they stopped at some point. But pretty much, we're pretty much dealing with, well, actually, there are two on here that are determinants, so I'll go with those. Plum Regal is determinant, and Garden Gem. But the rest of them are indeterminate.
How come the grocery stores can't get the flavor that we can on the farm?
I do have answers to this. Okay, so there are two, as far as I understand it, there are two big reasons for that. One is that most grocery store tomatoes are picked green, so underripe, in Florida, Mexico, California, wherever they're grown. And then they're ripened either in a truck or in warehouses once they've been transported to wherever they're going, probably many thousands of miles away. They're ripened using ethylene gas, which will help the tomato, you know, look ripe. It'll help the, you know, it get the red color. It'll help the carotenoids develop, but it will not help the sugars develop, because you need sunlight and photosynthesis to be going on in order to get the sugars to develop. So that's one of the reasons. You're just not going to get the sugar fixation from ethylene ripening on a tomato that's been picked green than you'll get from a tomato that's fresh from the vine. The other reason, which there's only a little bit of research on this, but it just makes tons of sense to me. I think the researcher's name was Powell, and he published in 2009 that your conventional grocery store tomato has been bred to turn red all at the same time. So if you think about a lot of heirloom tomatoes or some of the stranger varieties, they have the green shoulders for a long time after they ripen, right? Or they, you know, still have some discoloration. So they wanted the grocery store tomato to turn red all at once. Like, it's red, it's ripe, we know that. We're not having any green shoulders, there's no inconsistency, it's your archetypal red tomato. That cluster of genes that controls uniform ripening is actually linked to the genes that control sugar fixation. So not only are we picking the tomatoes green, and then before they have a chance to fix sugars, we're also genetically limiting their ability to fix sugars by breeding for this uniform ripening. Because the more uniform the ripening, the less ability in some ways, and there's probably a lot more nuance here that I'm missing, but in some ways it contributes to less sugar fixation and less flavor. Yeah?
Can you say that one more time?
Sure. Yeah. So it's not just one, it's like a cluster of genes that control uniform ripening, which is having it be all red instead of having it have green shoulders. That cluster of genes is linked to the genes that control sugar fixation, which again is a lot of genes. It's just they influence each other. It's not like a one-to-one thing. There's a lot of complicated interaction, but looking at things that have been bred to have uniform ripening, and then you can actually look at the DNA and see how close together that gene is with the main ones that control sugar fixation. And the ones that control sugar fixation are very closely linked. So there's some relationship there, most likely. Other people need to do some science on that, because you can't really base it on one publication. But I thought that publication was very convincing. And it actually has borne out in other people's flavor evaluations, too, that tomatoes that have the green shoulder, even though you have to cut off half the tomato because it's green, the part that's good is really good.
Tomatoes over the winter, as long as they ripen properly in the greenhouse.
You might have some day length issues there, because they do need a certain photo period during the day, so a certain number of hours of sunlight. But we're growing tomatoes, so I also work for AP Whaley, one of the companies that I mentioned before, and with Mark McCaslin, and we're growing tomatoes over the winter, but we have lights in the greenhouse that then, you know, will give the tomatoes the impression of it being summertime. I haven't tried them yet, but yeah, but I imagine they're probably not getting the heat either. You know, we're keeping them at a decent level, but they're not going to get that like good heat that you get in the summertime. But I will be tasting them in a couple of weeks, so we'll have to exchange information. I can let you know how it goes. Given this research, we would expect that they would taste good, but a lot of that probably has to do with heat.
What are your favorite heirlooms that aren't splitting?
Oh, favorite heirlooms that aren't splitting.
Large size.
That's a good, okay, so this dear friend, Keith Mueller, KC Tomatoes, he's brilliant. He also has a tomato called Gary Osena, which is Gary spelled G-A-R-Y like you'd expect, and then it's, the O is on the end of the Gary. It's really weird. Gary, capital O, and then S-E-N-A, Sena. That's a big, beautiful, dark purple with green shoulders tomato that is not an heirloom, but it's an OP. It looks like an heirloom. It's open pollinated. It's just, so an heirloom basically just means that it was, most of you probably know this, so sorry if I'm repeating what you already know, but an heirloom just means that it was something that the variety was established before around 1940, 1950. But we have a lot of modern open pollinated varieties that people have been selecting and saving in the same way as heirlooms. They just happen to be more recent. So Gary Osena is a version of that. It's a really, really good one. Let's see, what else? A6 is really good, but it does have the splitting issues. The Azurian Crown doesn't have a lot of splitting. That's the one with the, that's also from Keith Mueller. I know, this guy should be paying me. that has the dark purple top, but the, sort of the pink brandywine at the base. I really like, I'm kind of biased. I know people don't buy green tomatoes, but my favorite heirloom tomatoes are green tomatoes. Like the German greens, the Cherokee white, then those hardly split at all. But those are some of my favorites. We also, oh, Bear Creek is another one that did pretty well. That was high on the flavor spectrum, and because it's a bit smaller, it's also a dark kind of purple tomato, and that is an heirloom, I think.
Overall, people prefer the high acid to sugar or lower acid to sugar ratio in your taste tests?
People prefer the lower acid to sugar ratio, which was kind of surprising, I thought. It was actually the inverse of what some other people who did this research found, which is why we need to study it a little bit more. So there was a little bit of correlation between that lower acid to sugar ratio and preference, but it wasn't very strong.
yeah, you mentioned the importance of using varieties that are bred for organic production. So first of all, how did you select the varieties, and do you have any information as to how more conventionally bred varieties compare?
Yeah, so we did not do a comparison in this study of how more conventionally bred varieties compare, and not everything in this study was specifically bred for organic systems. They were all things that had organic seed being offered, and we asked the seed companies to send us their varieties that they were working on either breeding or adapting to organic systems. So it's kind of in that intermediate stage of we're trying to see what does well in organic systems so we can then give that information back to the breeding, back to the seed company or to the individual breeder and say, this does well, this is a good candidate for you to continue to work on your adaptation to organic systems. It was breeder's choice for the most part. And so, but other things that we asked them for were things that had good flavor and things that, you know, as you said, had been at least trialed in organic systems before, if not specifically bred. Because there are really only a few people who right now are currently actively doing breeding, looking at not only selecting varieties in organic systems, but actually focusing on certain traits that organic farmers say they need. So those are kind of two sides of the organic breeding coin that you have to have both of in order to know that you're going to get a good variety. So we just said seed companies, breeders, the farmers that we're working with are interested in really good flavor, they're interested in yield, and they're interested in disease resistance. So send us what you've got that you'd like to trial, preferably things that you have trialed or bred for organic systems and or things that are kind of new and coming through the pipeline, because that gets people excited. They don't want to try the same old thing. I keep saying Big Beef too because that was our Czech variety. We did not necessarily choose to grow Big Beef, but we compared everything else to Big Beef.